So far, I think. And people can share it. Sharing is a great film.
Okay, it's now 6 o'clock. So I have the privilege to welcome all of you to this the first lecture of our series. My name is Łukasz Buriok and I'm working here at Paideia. And I have the privilege to introduce Professor Yair Zakovitch, who is the father Takeshi Otsuki, professor of Bible at the Hebrew University of Jerusalem. His primary research interests are the Bible as literature, biblical thought, ancient interpretation of the Bible. Professor Zakovitch served as head of Institute of Jewish Studies at the Hebrew University and also as Dean of Humanities. And he has published numerous books and articles. And today we will have a lecture on the title Why Don't I Speak Swedish? The story of the Babel of Babel. And welcome. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Actually, it's the wrong title. Should have been, why don't you speak Hebrew? The reason I don't speak Swedish, A, I've never studied it, B, I'm not very talented for languages anyway. So, but why don't you speak Hebrew? Because you know, or perhaps you don't know, that the rabbis have said that the world was created in Hebrew. I just quote short paragraph from Midrash, you don't have it on your handouts. You know the verse Lazot ikare isha ki megish lukach hazot. She shall be called woman, isha, because she was taken out of a man. On the basis of this passage, you may draw, says the rabbis, the conclusion that the Torah was given in the holy language. Rabbi Pinchas and Rabbi Hilkiah, in the name of Rabbi Shimon, said that the Torah was given in the holy language, so the world was created in the holy language. So you should trust them. They are great rabbis. Anyway, but you know, there are great medieval traditions about scientific experiments that have been made. Some kings took newborns, a boy and a girl, put them on an island in the middle of the ocean with a wet nurse whose tongue was cut off. And the moment they started speaking, they immediately spoke perfect biblical Hebrew. Very scientific. Anyway, so in the beginning, everybody spoke Hebrew until we got to the story of the Tower of Babel. We are going to read the story and we are going to see what the story means, what the message of the story, perhaps more than one message, and what's even more important, how this story was interpreted within the Bible by other writers, narrators, prophets, etc. And you know that the story itself is on the 11th chapter of the book of Genesis. You should also know that the first 11 chapters of Genesis are sort of an introduction, the history of humanity, before we Israelites make our first step on the stage of history. We were a little late, the clock did not ring for us, so history goes on, the world is there, there are many societies already. And what happens in these 11 chapters? A series of catastrophes, the way we like it. It starts with us being expelled from the Garden of Eden. I still remember it. It's so painful. And it goes on to the flood, the big flood. Those of us who knew how to swim survive. And then, of course, when we reach the story of the God of the Tower of Babel, again, there is God sends us, disperses us all over the face of the earth. Why does it all happen? Because we don't know our place. Because we always try to look higher. People, Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, what did they do? They ate from the forbidden fruit. And then there was a danger that if they eat from the other fruit, the fruit of the tree of life, they'll be like God. And God likes keeping the monopoly for himself, so he sent them away. The flood starts after this time some creatures from heaven, sons of God, come down to earth and take for themselves the most beautiful girls. Again, the borderline is broken, and that's why the flood starts. That's in Genesis chapter 6. And in the story of the Tower of Babel, of course, humans try to climb to heaven to challenge God. God is upset. He confuses our languages and sends us away. So let's look at the story and try to understand it. There's not much to understand. And all of the earth was one language, one set of words. And it happened as they journeyed from the east, meaning after the flood, the new humanity one day wanders together from one place to another. They wander to the valley in the land of Shinar, which is the place where Babel is located, and settle there. And they said to each other, "Come, let us bake bricks and burn them hard." And the bricks served them as stone, and bitumen served them as mortar. And the Israelite writer is really surprised, perhaps not only surprised, but he also ridicules them. Because in our region, we have stones, we use stones for building. And they in Babel built all their buildings and towers and temples and palaces from bricks. So you see that the Israelite writer knows pretty well what's going on in Babel. It's quite surprising. And they said, verse 4, "Come, let us build us a city and a tower which with its head in heavens." And that's now they are challenging God. They want to reach heaven, they want to be like God. And they say that we may make us a name, lest we will be scattered all over the earth. Now, they are using their language. The language is their tool. The language is their tool to communicate with one another. And now they want to build this tower. And language, or being eloquent, is considered, you know, like it leads to pride. It leads to pride. You can look at text number three, for instance, quoting from the Song of Hannah in the Book of Samuel. Do not go on taking high and mighty arrogance slip from your mouth. For the God all knowing is the Lord, and He is the measure of action. Now these guys want to build a tower that reaches heaven. Again, shows you that the Israelites knew pretty well what was going on in Babel. They know that in Babel, in the city of Babel, actually the temple of Marduk. Marduk is the chief god of the Babylonian house of gods. And they want to build and they indeed in Babel built this temple with this huge tower to Marduk, a testimony of which we have in the Babylonian creation epic, the Enuma Elish. Look at text number two. The Enuma Elish, I quoted here just three lines. "For one whole year they molded bricks," again the bricks, you see. "When the second year arrived, they raised high the head of a sagila." A sagila, that's the tower in the temple, equaling Apsu. So it's so very high. And the Israelites now are going to mock them with this story that we are reading. So they build it in order to make themselves a name. Make themselves a name, a reputation. They are so very proud, lest we be scattered all over the earth. "And the Lord came down to see the city and the tower that the human creatures had built." I'm sure that God's vision is perfect. but still better than mine, for sure. But dealing with these midgets that think that they can build the tower that can reach heaven, he really has to come down and to look for the tower they have created. Yeah, who says that there is no sense of humor in the Bible? Of course there is. So he came down to see it, and the Lord said, as one people with one language is a dangerous tool. For all is this what they have begun to do. Now nothing they plot to do will elude them. Come, let us go down. He's going down again, even lower, and baffle their language. So they will not understand each other's language. Now they'll be speaking all strange languages, including Swedish, of course. And strange language or a foreign language is scary. You know, it's very scary for me to walk in the streets of Stockholm, not understanding what people are talking. Especially, you know, when you are not a free person, when you are, for instance, a slave and other people are speaking about you and you cannot understand. And that's what, for instance, a great fear when we were in Egypt. If you remember the song where I used to sing from Psalm 114, text number 5, when Israel came out of Egypt, the house of Jacob from barbarous tongue fog. The Tzet Israel in Mitzrayim, Beit Yaakov, Me'amrotes. The people that they speak a different language. Who knows what they are saying about us? And the same thing, the curse in Deuteronomy 28, text number 4, the Lord will carry against you a nation from afar, from the end of the earth, as the eagle swoops, a nation whose tongue you will not understand. That's the curse. A curse that was, of course, materialized when we were exiled from Zion and went to Babel. So that's quite scary. So the Lord scattered them all from there over the earth, and they left off building the city. And of course, he also baffled their language, therefore it's called Babel. Babel, for the Lord made the language of all earth Babel. Babel, because in Hebrew, the place is called Babel, Kisham Balal Adonai, it's Bat Kolar. It's a real resemblance between Babel and Balal. The question is whether the biblical narrator really believed himself. Did he really believe that Babel is called Babel because God confused the language of the peoples, or he was playing a game here? I'm not going to answer it yet. I want you to be tense a little, to wait a little until we get there. But I'll answer the question. Now we move on. Again, looking at the context into which this story is embedded, and now we reach text number 6. Our story is in chapter 11, but before chapter 11, usually 10 comes before 11, you know. So in chapter 10, you have a genealogical list. All the sons of Noah and their descendants. You know that Noah had three sons, Shem, Ham, and Japheth. So you have a list of Japheth's sons. It looks like a telephone guy or something like that. So you have the sons of Japheth, the sons of Ham, and then you get to the sons of Shem. Text 6, Noah's sons have born two to Shem, the father of all sons of Eber, the oldest brother of Japheth. Fine. And then you have our story right after that list. But immediately after our list, look at text 7 again. This is the lineage of Shem. Shem was 100 years old when he begot Arpachshad, etc., etc. Why do we have two lists of Shem surrounding our story? You know that Shem is a name, but Shem also is a word whose meaning is name. And what is our story about? About the people wanting to make themselves a name, Shem. And right after the second list of Shem starts the story of Abraham. Lech Lecha, you know the famous story when Abraham is commanded by God to leave his place and to go to the Middle East, to the Holy Land. And the Lord, text number 8, and the Lord said to Abraham, go forth from your land and your own birthplace and your father's house to the land I'll show you. And I'll make you a great nation, and I will bless you, and make your name great. Now you already see that it's all about name. The lists are about Shem, and the stories are about Shem. And these lists surround the stories in order to tell you, pay attention, Shem is going to be the most important thing now. And since the story about Babel is about Shem, and the story about Abraham is about Shem, now you are cordially invited to compare the two stories and to see the resemblances and the differences. And the message is always in the differences. Look, the people who built the tower, they moved or migrated voluntarily in order to build this tower. Abraham, on the other hand, he obeys God. He did not plan on migrating, but God commanded him, and he obeyed. These people wanted to make name for themselves. God is making a name for Abraham. That's the difference. Because he was so nice and was willing to leave his place and to go. And the story goes on. And he, I skipped some verses, and he pulled up his stakes from there for the high country east of Bethel, and pitched the tent with Bethel to the west and Ai to the east. And he built there an altar to the Lord, and he invoked the name of the Lord. You see the difference? He's also a builder, but he builds an altar for God. He doesn't build anything for himself, for his own reputation. He builds for God. And he does it for God's sake, for the name of God. So this way, Abraham is presented to us as the opposite of the builders of the Tower of Babel. With Abraham, we have a chance. If it works or not, that's a different story, but at least that's the idea here. Now, still within the book of Genesis, we have another story, and that's the story of Jacob's dream. How is the story of Jacob's dream in Bethel related to our story of the Tower of Babel? Text number 9. And Jacob left Beersheba, meaning when he had to escape, you remember he stole the blessing that his father wanted to give his brother Esau, and he's escaping. First night without mommy, not very easy. Out in the open there, and Jacob left Beersheba and set out for Haran, and he came upon a certain place and stopped there for the night, for the sun had set, and he took one of the stones, you know, again, we have stones, they have bricks, so he took one of the stones of the place and put it under his head, and he lay down in that place. He's not trying to climb, he's not going anywhere. He's as flat as possible. He's lying down there. And he dreamed. And look, a ramp or a ladder. That's the famous story about the ladder, which is not exactly a ladder, but who cares? By the way, the Hebrew word here is sulam. Sulam is hapax legomenon, meaning a word that appears only once in the Bible, but it's known to us from Babylonian, actually, the word. Similtu. And actually, the tower in Marduk's temple is exactly this similitude. So he saw a ramp, and look, a ramp was set against the ground with its top reaching the heavens. Bingo! Now we know that these two stories are related to one another. Something starts in here, ending in heaven. And look, angels or messengers of God were going up and coming down it. By the way, now you know that angels in the Bible don't have wings. The poor guys had to climb up and down, up and down, up and down. It wasn't easy at all. And look, the Lord was poised over him, and he said, I, the Lord, and the God of Abraham, your father, and the God of Isaac, the land on which you lie, to you I will give it, and to your seed. Now that he is leaving the land, God is calming him down, telling you, still, you'll be back, it's going to be all yours. I promise it to your father, to your grandfather, it will all be yours. And your seed shall be like the dust of the earth, and you shall burst forth to the west, and to the east, and to the north, and to the south. Again, there's something interesting, because again, we're talking about dispersing them all over the earth, but here, it's not a curse. Here it's a blessing. The seed of Jacob will be, he'll have so many descendants that actually they'll cover the earth. And all the clans of the earth shall be blessed through you and through your seed. And look, I'm with you, and I'll guard you wherever you go, and I'll bring you back, etc., etc. And Jacob awoke, verse 16, from his sleep, and he said, indeed, the Lord is in this place, and I did not know. And he was afraid, and he said, how fearsome is this place? This can be but the house of God, and this is the gate of the heavens. Ha, 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 that's the most important sentence. This is the gate of heavens. Of course it's the gate of heavens, because there is an opening there, and the ladder is standing up here, and then angels are going up and down, so this is the gate. He's in the very place of heaven's gate. Why is it so important? Now let's go back to the name Babel. What is the real meaning of the name Babel? Not what's written in Genesis 11. The real meaning of the name Babel is Bab Ilu, the gate of the gods, the gate of heaven. So our Israelite writer mocks the Babylonians, does it twice. Mocks them one time with the story about them trying to build this tower, which is good for nothing. They think that the gate of heaven is in their territory. Ha ha, they are wrong. The gate of heaven, the writer is a local patriot. The gate to heaven is here in Babel. That's what the narrator is trying to tell us. So you see that the narrator was no idiot. He knew exactly what the original meaning of Babel, Babel is, but he's telling us now it's here. So you see that this story is, again, an exact opposite, like a mirror reflection of the story of the Tower of Babel. Because again, there, these guys, they were building this tower in order to reach heaven, etc., etc., to make themselves a name. Our Jacob is lying down there, he doesn't do anything. It's the divine creatures who go up and down and make the connection between heaven and earth. And Jacob, who's so very nice, when he gets up in the morning now, look what he's doing. And Jacob rose early in the morning and took the stone he had put at his head and set it as a pillar and poured oil over its top. Put it as a pillar, meaning like an indication of the tower, of the ladder he saw when he was asleep, and pours oil on it, meaning again honoring God. He is doing what he is doing, what he's doing in order to honor God. And after he says what he says that I'm skipping some lines, and this stone that I set as a pillar will be a house of God. The house of God, Beit Elohim, Beit El, the name of the place, of course, is Beit El. Beit El, by the way, was the central temple of the northern kingdom of the Kingdom of Israel. We in Judah had Jerusalem, and they in the northern kingdom, the kingdom of Israel, and Babel as the royal temple, the most important one. So here you have a story about the foundation of Babel, how it all started by Jacob, who was so much better than the Babylonians. God appeared to him, he understood the message, so very nice. Okay, now Babylonian pride. In this story, of course, in Genesis 11, the story of the Tower of Babel, we see how these people are so proud, they want to make themselves a name. So this became like a motif that goes through the Bible. Babylonian kings are always so very proud, they want to reach heaven. Text number 10, you have a lament, but actually it's a pseudo-lament. Nobody is sad for the death of the king of Babel. The prophet is actually very happy that the king of Babel is dead. And here you have part, a paragraph from his lament. How are you fallen from heaven, O shining one, son of Rome? How are you fell to earth, a vanquisher of nations? Once you thought in your heart, I will climb to the sky. Again, you see the same thing. Babylonians always want to climb to the sky. Higher than the stars of God, I will set my throne. I'll see it in the Mount of Assembly, Assembly of the Gods. On the summit of Tzafon. Mount Tzafon was known to be like the mountain where all the gods actually live together, Mount Tzafon. I will mount the back of the cloud. I will match the Most High. Again, you see the competition, the challenging God. The king of Babel wants to climb up to heaven, to be on the cloud, to be like the Most High, meaning like God, to challenge God. Instead, you are brought down to Sheol. Sheol is the underworld, where all the dead are, to the bottom of the pit. Ha ha. And we are so happy today. Anyway, by the way, I have to say something about, I mentioned that also in Babel, they have these traditions about the sulam, the similitude, this ladder. But it's very interesting because in our story, the story of Jacob in Babel, the ladder starts here on the face of the earth and goes up to heaven. In the Babylonian tradition, the ladder has two parts. It starts in Sheol, in the underworld, and it gets here, and then the second part starts from here and goes up to heaven. And that's why we are talking here in this prophecy, it's not just falling from heaven to the earth, but it's actually falling down to Sheol. Okay, now another story about the Babylonian king, and this king is Nebuchadnezzar. It's a story in the book of Daniel, and people for some reason never read Daniel. I don't know why, but people never get there. They fall asleep before they get to Daniel when they read the Bible before the night. I don't know. Anyway, the book of Daniel is a very strange book. It's divided into two parts. The first part, chapters 1 to 6, are stories. Chapters 7 to 12 are visions that Daniel had. The first part is mostly in Aramaic. These stories are about Daniel, mostly about Daniel, a wunderkind that was exiled from Judah, made it to Babel, was taken into the royal palace, studied there some the Babylonian language, some Babylonian general studies, and then was taken to the court to serve in the court. And since he was so smart, of course, one of us. He was so smart, he became number two to the king. And of course, everybody else was so jealous that this Jew made it, you know, up. Actually, when you read these stories, you feel that you are reading again the stories of Joseph. And indeed, the stories were actually patterned after the story of Joseph. Because what can a Jew in exile dream? He cannot dream that a Jew will replace Carl Gustav. But he can dream that the Jew will be his advisor. He'll be number two to the king. And as Joseph, himself has become an interpreter of dreams, you remember, he interprets the dreams of Pharaoh, so Daniel is interpreting the dreams of Nebuchadnezzar. And here, I copied actually too much from the story. I didn't copy the first part of it in which the king has his dream, because anyway, when Daniel interprets it, he goes over the whole dream again. So, enough. We have enough. Then Daniel called Belshazzar, because Jews in exile changed their names. You remember also in the book of Esther, for instance, you have it that Hadassah became Esther, etc. So the name Belshazzar was perplexed for a while. After he hears the terrible dream of the king, he's perplexed and alarmed by his thoughts. The king addressed him, "Let the dream and its meaning not alarm you." Belshazzar replied, "My lord, would that the dream were for your enemies and its meaning for your foe, meaning it's a terrible dream that you have had. The tree that you saw grow and become mighty, whose top reached heaven," again we are talking about reaching heaven, "which was visible throughout the earth, whose foliage was beautiful, whose fruit was so abundant, and there was food for all in it, beneath which the beasts of the field dwelt, and in whose branches the birds of the sky lodged, it is you." Meaning, actually, the king had a dream that he is, if you want, the tree of life. That all creatures of the world count on him for life and for fruit. "O king, you have grown and become mighty, whose greatness has grown to reach heaven, and whose dominion is to the end of the earth." The holy watcher, actually an angel, a messenger, whom the king saw descend from heaven. Here, you remember in the story of the Tower of Babel, it was God himself who was descending down to punish humans. Here it's an angel that is coming down. And what does the angel say? "You down the tree and destroy it, but leave the stump with its roots in the ground, in feathers of iron and bronze, in the grass of the field. Let him be drenched with the dew of heaven and share the lot of the beasts of the field until seven seasons pass over him." Meaning, the king is going to be like an animal. Meaning, he won't be able to speak. He'll lose his ability to speak. He won't be a human being now for seven long years. "This is the meaning, O king. It is the decree of the Most High which has overtaken my lord the king. You will be driven away from men and have your habitation with the beasts of the field. You will be fed grass like cattle and be drenched with the dew of heaven. Seven seasons will pass over you, 7 years, until you come to know that the Most High is sovereign over the realm of men, and he gives it to whom he wishes." And the meaning of the command to leave the stump of the tree with its roots in the ground, blah, 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 because the kingdom remains yours from the time you come to know that heaven is sovereign. Meaning at some point you'll be given a second chance after 7 years of being punished. "Therefore, O king, may my advice be acceptable to you. Redeem your sins by beneficence and your iniquities by generosity to the poor. Then your serenity may be extended." Meaning, you had a dream and the dream is going to be materialized, but if you change your behavior drastically now, perhaps the punishment will be postponed. But 12 months later, as he was walking on the roof of the royal palace, He's so proud. He's going there on the top, on the roof of the palace at Babylon. The king exclaims, "Oh, there is great Babylon, which I have built by my vast power to be the royal residence for my glory and my majesty." You see how he is so very proud, like the builders of the tower, so proud of himself, so happy with himself. He feels like God. The words were still on the king's lips when a voice fell from heaven. "It has been decreed for you, O King Nebuchadnezzar, the kingdom has passed out of your hands. You are being driven away from men, and your habitation will be with your animals," blah, 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 blah. And of course, it all happened as he saw it in the dream. But 7 years later, of course, he, in verse 31, said, "When the time had passed, I, Nebuchadnezzar, lifted my eyes to heaven." Now he understands. Now he's not looking down from the top of the palace, but he is standing low down there and looking up to heaven, and he knows this place very well. "And my reason was restored to him." He's a human being again, and he has language again. "I bless the Most High." Now he doesn't think that he is like the Most High, but he is blessing the Most High. "And praise and glorify the everlasting one whose dominion is an everlasting dominion, and whose kingdom endures throughout the generations," etc., etc. Now, more prophecies. More prophecies. And the prophecy we are going to read down now, where we have two more prophecies, short prophecies to read. And the prophecy we are going to read now is a prophecy from the book of Isaiah. The students have already read it with me. It's the most famous prophecy in the Bible. It's the prophecy of Isaiah for the days to come, when all the nations will come to Jerusalem. I'm saying that it's the most famous prophecy in the Bible because so many allusions are being made to this prophecy. So many prophets are referring to this prophecy. Everybody knew it. Prophets who agreed with it and prophets who didn't agree with it, but it was so very well known. And what does it say? "In the days to come," and the days to come, you have to understand this term. In Hebrew, it's acharit hayamim. And some people take it wrong, as if acharit hayamim means the end of days, the end of history. No. Acharit hayamim in biblical Hebrew means at some point in the future. And this some point in the future may happen in a few minutes before I end the lecture. I hope it. They will wait a little. But it can happen 1,000 years from now. We don't know. In the days to come. "In the days to come, the mount of the Lord's house shall stand firm above the mountains and tower above the hills." Those of you who have been to Jerusalem, and I think that I'm pretty sure that many of you have been there, know that Temple Mount is not Mount Everest. There is a slight difference. And yet, here we are being told that when it happens, this is going to be the tallest mountain on the face of the earth. Why is it so important to say that it's going to be so tall? Temporary answer. Well, since people are going now to wander from Sweden, from Yemen, from all corners of the world, they start walking towards Jerusalem, they should see where they are going to. Well, that's not a very good answer, but take it as a temporary one. But the moment, actually, you think about this story as being the opposite of the story of the Tower of Babel, now you understand why this mountain is going to be the tallest of all mountains. But this time, it's not me or you or any human building a structure that is so very tall, but it's an initiative of God. He will make, he is the only one who's capable of making the mountain so very tall. And all the nations, Lord's house is stand above, and all the nations shall gaze on it with joy. Actually, again, the Hebrew term, Naharu elav kol hagoyim, you can understand it in two different ways. The Naharu can be derived from the word Nahar, meaning all nations will flow towards it, flow like a river. They preferred in this translation, and in many of the ancient translations too, to interpret it as they'll be so happy, meaning you'll see the light in their eyes, because Nehara, another noun very similar to Nehara, is just light, or. So everybody who walks now towards Jerusalem will be so very happy. And the many people shall go and say, come, let us go up to the mount of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob. You remember what the people said then when they were about to build the tower. Let's go, let's make ourselves a name, let's build this tower. These guys now are not going to build anything, they are going to climb. And they climb to the house of the Lord. And why are they? What's their motive? We remember what was the negative motive of those who built the tower. But here we have a very positive one, that he may instruct us in his ways and that we may walk in his path. Meaning, they are here to learn, they are not here to teach, they are not here to challenge the Lord, but they are here to learn his ways, to serve him actually. And look at the last sentence I just read, that he may instruct us, they are still passive, he is teaching them, but immediately they are becoming also very active, they are ready to learn, that we may walk in his path. And what started as a physical walk, when they said, let us go up to the mountain, becomes now a spiritual walk, they are ready to walk in his path. For instruction shall come forth from Zion, and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. Here I have to put some brackets, and to say that this story, or this prophecy, I'm sorry, is not just the opposite of the story of the Tower of Babel, but it's also the opposite, a mirror reflection of another well-known story in the Bible, which is the story of the giving of the law on Mount Sinai. Because here you read now that instruction shall come forth from Zion, the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. We have the second giving of the law here. And look how different this second giving of the law, how different it is from the first giving of the law. The first giving of the law, first of all, it was given just to us. It was an exclusive club. Nobody else was allowed to get there. That's one check, one difference. B, you remember that when the law was given to us, we were not allowed to get close to the mountain. We were not allowed to touch the mountain. And now, please come up, all of you. Israelites, non-Israelites, everybody is allowed to climb the mountain. And something else. When we got the Torah on Mount Sinai, the picture of the situation, it was so violent. The mountain was trembling. Here, already when we start reading this prophecy, in the days to come, the Mount of the Lord's house shall stand firm. It won't move. It's all so very quiet. If there is light here, it's the light in the eyes of the people, but there we had lightnings and thunderstorms. Here it's a very peaceful prophecy because it's about peace. What is the, why do we have here a prophecy which is the mirror reflection of the story of the giving of the law on Mount Sinai? What is the original story about? Again, as I said, an exclusive club. The story of the giving of the law on Mount Sinai wants to promote a separatist ideology. The world is here and we are there. We have nothing to do with them. Our Torah is given to us by God, very different from any other law that any nation has. Look, the monotheistic religion was so very young, so very fragile. In order to protect it, they had to come up with a story that the Torah was given to us in the wilderness, in this cultural vacuum, nobody around. What the prophet now is doing is the ultimate prophecy. As if he says, well, you know, I understand why when we were young we had to separate ourselves from the rest of the world, because we didn't have faith yet, our religion was not stable yet, we looked around, we looked for idol worshipping, etc., etc. But now, kids, it's about time we grow up. Now we don't have a reason to be afraid anymore. We can let the other come. We can let the others come. And now that I get back to the story of the Tower of Babel and this prophecy being the mirror reflection of it. In the Tower of Babel, of course, they wanted to challenge God, they were not alarmed, God did not let them build the tower, etc., etc. And God confused their languages so they could not understand one another. Here, humanity is getting a second chance. Now, God did not want them to be united in the first story because they used their unity to challenge Him. Now He is ready to give humanity a second chance because He understands, or at least the prophet understands, that only if people are united, if they all come to Jerusalem, if they are all ready to accept the authority of the Lord, there will be peace. Because as long, I said what I said 17 minutes ago, about foreign languages. When you don't know the other, when you don't speak the language of the other, you don't understand what he's talking about, you know nothing about him, you know nothing about his religion, you're very suspicious of him. But the moment we can talk to one another, we can communicate with one another, we can get together and accept the same authority, then there is no room for war anymore. And that's why this prophecy goes on. Thus, he will judge among the nations and decide for many peoples, and they shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nations shall not take up sword against nation. They shall never again learn war. There will be peace with the new chance given to humanity. The end of the prophecy is quite funny. As I said earlier, we don't know if it's going to happen tonight or 3,000 years from now, but who knows, we have to be ready. So the prophecy ends, O house of Jacob, come let us walk by the light of the Lord. We have to do it right now. They may come, you know, 100 years from now, 200 years from now, but when they come, we should at least already do it. We should already walk by the light of the Lord, and here you have the light again. Fine. You see that biblical prophets are great poets. What makes a great poet? First, being talented, I guess. But something else. Great poets have depth to their poetry. Meaning they know all the pieces of poetry and they always have it in dialogue with all the pieces. And you see, one can read this prophecy in a very shallow way, but the moment you realize what the prophet has done, meaning put his prophecy as a mirror reflection of the story of the giving of the law, as a mirror reflection of the story of the Tower of Babel, then you see some depth to this prophecy and you understand the message very well. Now, another prophecy, the last one, from the prophecy of Zephaniah, a very short book, just three chapters, very humble person, Zephaniah. And he says so. For when I will make the peoples pure of speech, in Hebrew, he's speaking about Safa Berura, clear speech, meaning a speech that people will understand. And again, they will understand one another. He's playing on our story, because their god Baal, the language was Safa Belula, mixed, confused, and here it's going to be Safa Berura. You know that R and L, if you have Japanese friends, you'll know that R and L get totally confused. So for them, I will make the peoples pure of speech. Their language will become clear again. So that they all invoke the Lord by name. You see, he is giving humanity a second chance. He knows that this time they will not, with their pure language, common language, they will not try to challenge him, but they will invoke his name. That the Lord, so that they all invoke the Lord by name and serve him with one accord. From beyond the rivers of Cush, my supplicants from Putzai. If you look at the map, or the Atlas, or Google Earth, you will not find a place like Putzai. But in the story of the Tower of Babel, when God scatters them, the verb is lehafitz. Putzai is from lehafitz, meaning all the people that I have scattered. That's what it meant by putzai. All the people who pray to me, all my supplicants from all over the earth, from putzai, from where I have scattered them, shall bring offerings to me. In that day, and now he's talking to the people of Jerusalem. Because the people of Jerusalem were as guilty as the builders of the Tower of Babel. They were also proud, and that's why they were punished. Again, brackets, just for 1 minute. Look how well biblical historiography, the historical books of the Bible are planned. I said the first 11 chapters of the Bible start with two exiles. We are exiled from the Garden of Eden, and then we are exiled again after we build the tower. And what happens at the very end of the Book of Kings? Two exiles again. Israel is exiled to Assyria, Judah is exiled to Babylon. So that's like the frame of the historical books. So now, and why were we exiled? Because we did not learn the message. If we were smart enough, we would have understood, we would have looked what happened to them at the beginning of history, and we would have learned. But since we did not pay attention, and we did not learn, we were exiled. But now God is giving us a second chance. So he says, in that day you will no longer be shamed for all the deeds by which you have defied me. For then I will remove the proud and exultant within you. Meaning you are proud like the Babylonians. Now you will not be proud anymore, and you will be haughty no more on my sacred mount. But I will leave within you a poor, humble folk, and they shall find refuge in the name of the Lord. Again, the name plays such an important role. Not your name, do nothing for your own name. They, meaning you, our people, will find refuge in the name of the Lord. The remnant of Israel shall do no wrong and speak no falsehood. A deceitful tongue shall not be in their mouth. Only such as this shall graze and lie down, with none to trouble them. So you see, all these biblical texts, and I have not brought all biblical texts that refer to the story of the Tower of Babel. I know that they are limited to your patience. But you see how important this story becomes in biblical literature. Different literary units representing different genres, let it be prophecies or stories, etc., refer to this story. And if I have to sum up what we have done today or this afternoon, first of all, we saw that the biblical narrator is far from being naive, and he knows quite a lot, even about what's going on in Babel. And he knew not only that they used bricks, but perhaps he was also familiar with the traditions of the Enumaelish, the Babylonian creation epic. And putting this story, the story of the Tower of Babel, with the story of Jacob's dream together, you see how he actually mocks the Babylonians. And he is a local patriot, and the gate of heaven is here in Babel. But the whole idea that the Babylonians are proud, of course, Babel is such a great nation, at least as for those people, Babel was more than the USA, more than the Soviet Union, you name it. And when you see such a great nation, you believe that it's a very proud nation. So again and again, biblical writers, you know, deal with the pride of Babel, with the pride of the kings of Babel, who always want to climb to heaven. And they have to learn their lesson. So it's in the lament of Isaiah, it's in the story of Daniel about Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babel. And it's sad, and I'm sure that the writer of the story of Daniel about Nebuchadnezzar was so happy writing his story. Nebuchadnezzar is the king who conquered Jerusalem, who ruined the temple of Jerusalem, who exiled all of us. And here we can tell a story that he learned his lesson. And now at the end of his story, he blesses the Lord and says that there is no other God, and there is nobody greater than our God. That's a great satisfaction. And this story is also used by biblical prophets like Zephaniah in order to tell us that we were as proud as the Babylonians and we have to learn our lesson. And also by Isaiah, who creates a new world. And in the new world, nobody will be proud and all of them will come to Jerusalem and we will have peace. Great. Thank you very much. Suggestions, objections. And if not, I wish you all a good time.
There are some questions.
Oh, yeah. Please.
Well, thank you for this.
You're very welcome.
And I guess I challenged the whole concept because I speak both Swedish and Hebrew. I'm thinking about the relation between the symbolic relation between mountains and towers. So if a mountain is a place where theophany can happen,
yeah.
Is the tower then a man-made construct with the same potential?
Exactly. So yes, no. When you build a tower, you don't expect a theophany. It's the opposite. You challenge God. You want to be like Him. On mountains, God appears, you have a theophany. In the tower, you want to tell Him, I'm as good as you are, as big as you are, perhaps even
more. So it's all about the reaching up and
being humble. Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah.
The Jacob's ladder, is it, you said that sources provide the explanation like a platform or a
It's like a ziggurat, like a spiral construction going up. Yeah. It's not the letter you see that you climb. Okay. Good night again.